We're so excited to have you all here. If I can get a real quick check in this chat, give us a one if you're super familiar with Instituto, you've been to our trainings before, you know what we're about, or two, if this is your first time here with us today, or you're not so sure who Instituto is, if you can drop this in the chat, that'd be super helpful. All right, looks like we got a good mix today. Well, thank you all for joining us. We're very excited to have you. My name is Ariel Reyes, and I'm the political director at Instituto. This is our Media 102 training. There is a Media 101 training that we've also recorded. So if you're interested in that at the end of the training, please feel free to reach out to me, and I'll leave my email address in the chat. So let me go ahead and get us kicked off here. Like I said, I'm the political director here at Instituto, and what Instituto does is we build political power for communities of color and low-income communities. So a lot of the partners we work with, these are the communities that they work with, and we help build their skill sets, do some high-level strategizing with them, do coaching. So if there's an organizer that, you know, needs to figure out some budget pieces or wants to know more about relational organizing, those are things that we help with at Instituto, as well as with like data, field, digital communications, you name it. We're here to support the infrastructure in Arizona. So as you see here, you know, we do this by providing incubation, acceleration, and capacity building for both individuals and organizations. And our coaching and everything is always free to our community members. And today, we're excited to bring you this Media 102 training. So I'm very excited to introduce you to Maria Hurtado. She has worked in communications for nonprofits, on campaigns, and on the official side. Most recently, she served in the House as communications director for a New Mexico congresswoman, and she worked on Mark Kelly's 2020 campaign, where she served as his press secretary. Now she's at Declaration Media, where she advises on earned and paid communication strategy. We're very excited to have Maria and all her expertise here with us today. And I know we have a packed training here, so I'm going to go ahead and hand it off to Maria.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I see, I think, a good chunk of familiar names from that Media 101 training, so it's really nice to see everyone or see y'all's names again. But for anyone who wasn't able to join the first one, I'm Maria. Like Ariel said, my background is in communications. I was a comms director for Congresswoman Teresa Leche Fernandez. I was in Arizona in 2020, worked on Senator Gillibrand's presidential campaign, and have done field work in North Carolina. And now I'm a Declaration, where I advise on earned and paid comms, as well as write and direct ads in Spanish and in English for campaigns. So excited to be with you guys today and build on some of the stuff that we talked about in Media 101. So we have three learning objectives this time around. Number one, we're going to run through some of the terminology that you should expect to use with reporters, that you should be really comfortable with when you talk to them. We'll talk about how to pitch your stories and some of the different types of pitching that you have at your disposal. We'll talk through how to identify and properly prep your spokespeople, and especially when you need them and when you don't need them, because they're not always necessary. And then we'll go through some best practices for staffing interviews, whether you do that currently or you want to do more of that, both virtual and in person. We'll talk through some best practices for that. So when you're speaking with reporters and pitching, for a lot of people, myself included, when I started out, it was probably one of the more intimidating things that you can do. You know, you can be afraid of saying the wrong thing, of maybe not having an answer to a reporter's question, because you never know what they can throw out at you, or just like fearing that your pitch might fall flat. Those are all normal anxieties to have around this line of work, but like anything else you'll ever do, there's so much that you can do at the front end to make sure that you're best prepared to get your stories placed and to just have a conversation with reporters and build relationships with them, like as people. So we'll start with just some basic terminology that I'm sure some of you guys already know, but can't hurt to go through real quick. So before we really get down and talk about pitching, I just wanted to start off with going through some of like the ranges of quotability and the rules for attribution when you're speaking to a reporter that you really want to make sure you have down. So there's three of them, right? Off the record, on background, and on the record. Off the record, anything you say is off limits and cannot be used for publication at all, right? If you're pitching something off the record, this is good when you kind of want to put an idea into a reporter's head and like on their radar. It kind of ensures that you're one of the first people to go to them and give them your take on what's going on with this story. So this is about shaping a story the way you want it to, the way your organization wants it to be shaped. But it is something that you do need to establish from the very beginning that you are off the record, and it has to be something that is agreed upon by both parties. So if you call up a reporter and you like are really nervous and you say like, hey, I want to talk off the record about this, and then you dive into it without the reporter having said, yeah, it's off the record, let's talk. Everything you've just said has been on the record. So just make sure that you're always on the same page before you start giving them the information that you have. And I would say it's important, like usually my go-to is email first when you're pitching. And obviously you want to let them know, hey, I would like to have this conversation completely off the record, but here's kind of where it goes. Give them like a little sneak peek into what you want to talk about. Not enough that they can guess what it is, but enough to, you know, intrigue them and make them want to hear more. A lot of people get a little nervous about speaking off the record because they kind of see it as like a, you know, what good is this going to do if they can't take this information and print it? A reporter still benefits like a lot from having an off the record conversation with you. They will need to do the work to like corroborate what you're saying and make sure that there's a story really there and there are citations to go along with it. But what they're also getting, it's an opportunity to see this source in a way that's like unguarded. It's an unguarded situation. And you can be sure that they're looking to see if you or your spokesperson like really knows what they're talking about, how you talk about it, you know, when you're off the record. And what you say won't be printed, but they're definitely looking to see if you are a source that can be trusted, if they want to speak to you again, you know, like how much value you're bringing into the story that you're pitching. So still prep your spokespeople, still prep yourself for an off the record conversation. And, you know, be a little unguarded. That's totally fine. You're talking to another person, but you're also just talking to a journalist. So always keep that in the back of your head. When you pitch something on background, it's mostly when people just don't want their names published, but they will agree to some sort of description of their position. So anytime you've seen in a story, like a government official or someone with ties to some person or a source close to whoever, that was an interview that they got on background. And the way it goes, you know, there's some negotiation about how much they'll be able to describe your position. And that's completely up to you, a place where you're comfortable. And they're going to want to work with you on that because they're going to want your comment, your level of expertise in their story. So, you know, there's some negotiation there. But sources come to reporters with all sorts of like on background for all sorts of reasons. Among them is like, you know, setting a fact straight, like if there's a lawsuit of some sort and you want to go on background with some of the facts, with some of the previous events that led up to it, that's something that you could do. Or even I would say like putting pressure on a public figure. A lot of times people go on background with that and they just don't want their names attached to it. But I would say one of my biggest recommendations for when you're pitching a reporter, either off the record or on background, is if possible, and if you have the time to do this, make sure that you have some people that can go on the record to back up what you're saying. This kind of goes a step beyond what people usually do because it is the reporter's job to kind of find those people. But if you have people that you work with that know what you're doing, what your goal is, and are lined up with it, and are willing to go on the record. My recommendation is always to do your pitch, do it off the record, and then tell the reporter, like, I have people that are willing to go on the record for you, let me contact you with them. And that's completely fair game to do. People really, like reporters really appreciate you putting in that extra effort. It cuts down some steps for them. It kind of ensures that you continue to shape the story the way you want it to be shaped without doing it yourself. Like you're giving them the sources essentially. And then on the record, probably the more obvious one and most preferred by reporters too, I would say. And the assumption here is that literally everything is on the record and everything is fair game to be published. And people sometimes forget that that goes beyond the words that come out of your mouth. That is applicable to body language, eye rolls, anything that you do in that interview can be used. So this is helpful for two reasons. Number one, if you have a spokesperson or you yourself find that in a situation where you need to be a little bit more detached from it, a little bit, you know, more, you know, you have like strong feelings about something, but as a source, you don't want to bring those to the interview, make sure you check yourself on that. And if you have a spokesperson that maybe, you know, can't hold back an eye roll or can't hold back some sort of gesture, just remind them before they walk into an interview that everything they do and say is on the record. But also you can use it to your advantage. Like if you want to be a little bit more bold and you want an eye roll, it's by no means like a sure thing that a reporter will write the eye roll into their story, but you can try and it might make it its way in there. But one of the things, just to really emphasize this, like always try to be on the same page with the reporter about where you are in this like level of quotability. Like sometimes you'll go and you'll talk to them off the record and they'll come back to you and they'll say like, hey, I can't find anyone to back up what you're saying. Like no one's willing to go on the record. Can you do it? At that point, you know, it's completely up to you and the members of your organization, like whether you want to put your name on that piece of information, but just make sure that you're always communicating where you're at. And that you're always allowing them the space and the time to confirm that they are with you. So, and this applies whether you're talking to TV reporters, newspaper reporters, like any journalist, just always, it's better to be safe than sorry, always be overly communicative about where you're at. And so we'll just run through a couple of pitches, like three types of pitches. Once your team establishes kind of the best course for how you want to be quoted or how you want to go about the pitch, you can get the ball rolling on actually getting that information to the reporter. So a pitch literally is just you reaching out to a reporter and offering something that you know is of value to them, specifically with the intention of securing coverage for your organization. So for this one, we'll talk about three, and then, you know, the general pitch. This is kind of like an extension of what we talked about in the Media 101 training, when we talked about following up with people after sending out press releases or advisories. Most of the time you'll have a top targets list. Like say you have like a really big press list, you're not expected to personally touch base with every person that has received your communication. So you want to build kind of like a top targets, like aim high, who, if you know, if it were up to me, who would I want to come? And type out a pitch for them, right? I put in an example of one that is very general. Like most of the time, I didn't have the luxury of being able to do a targeted pitch for every single reporter that I wanted to go. And you kind of just have to draft this catch-all that kind of sounds like it is personalized, but most of the time it's not. If you do have like three people that are your top targets that you like, that is the dream, like you want them to write about your subject, I would recommend taking this pitch and making it even more personal. Whether it be like, you know, you caught one of their reporting and you put it into your press list in that notes column, and you want to reference that and, you know, specifically call them out on that, like, you know, thank you for your reporting on this. I love the way you wrote this part. Whatever you need to do to kind of make that personal connection with a reporter, that takes this general pitch up a level. But of course, that's only if you have time. It won't always happen, but when it does, it lands really well. And even if the reporter doesn't bite and like take the pitch and write about it, you at least kind of broke through with them. And it's like, you know, step one into building a stronger relationship, and they'll appreciate the fact that you kind of know what you're talking about, right? Like, you're following their work and you respect their work, and that'll get you a really long way. The second type of pitch, this one is when you pitch under embargo. And what this means is that you are giving the journalist the information in advance of the announcement with the agreement that they are not to publish anything until a specific time that you have set for them. This is not like, I know before we talked about, like, you know, when, if you're going like on background, there's some negotiation for what they can say. There's no negotiation for what an embargo time is. This is completely, you know, what works best for you. And usually that time and date is lined up with when you want to go live with your announcement. So when you're pitching something under embargo, say you have like a big announcement, like a new ED, or you're announcing like really big fundraising numbers or a big study that you're publishing, what you want to do with a pitch that's under embargo is essentially give them everything that you have ahead of time in order to allow them to sit with it, to understand it, write a really, really strong piece. Like, you know, they have time to talk with people and do interviews, talk with you and like get facts straight. And then the idea is that when you put your release out, when you announce it, that their story is published alongside of that. And it is like guaranteed press coverage of it before you even send out the release. So it's really helpful. It just means that your particular piece of news has to be like really newsworthy and like really like deserving of you spending all of this time ahead of the announcement, making sure that these stories are accurate and as good as you want them to be. For embargo pitches, make sure that you communicate really clearly again here that these things are under embargo for, say, like Sunday, March 5th at 8 a.m. Mountain Standard Time. Like, you want to be like super, super detailed about when that embargo lifts, because you might be working with a reporter in Arizona, but that reporter might be working with an editor somewhere else who is in a different time zone. And the last thing you want to do is have any miscommunication about when this story needs to go live. I would say you can give information under embargo to multiple reporters. You can give it to one in an exclusive that we'll talk about next, but there's no limit to how many people you can give something under embargo. The one thing that I would advise is that if you are sending to multiple people, just make it clear that it's not an exclusive. Like, I've worked with reporters who kind of assumed that it was an exclusive, and halfway through I had to be like, no, this is, multiple people are getting this, you're one of them. And they were like a little bit upset, but nothing that it's, you know, if you don't do it ahead of time and there's a little bit of miscommunication, you can fix that down the line. But to avoid it, just like be really clear about what this is and what kind of pitch this is. Both parties do, again, need to agree to the embargo. So when you are pitching and you're drafting your pitch for something that you want to send under embargo, the first email should not include any materials that give any detail that is under embargo. Like, draft a pitch, again, that is interesting enough, that doesn't give too much away, but that will at least make them want to see the materials. Very few reporters will read your first pitch and say, yes, I'm going to write about that, until they've seen the materials. So just get them to agree to review the materials under that embargo agreement, and then send everything to them. That last bullet point is really important, because anything you send to them, any press release, any like materials, whether they are final or not, should have a note at the top that says under embargo until date, time zone. I usually do it as a footer or like a header if it's like a Word doc, but it should be on every single page that you send them. If it's a 10-page document, every page should have that note at the top in red and bold. This just makes sure, it's kind of like a water stamp of sorts. And it just means that if the reporter were to print it out or send it, or like not send the full document, everyone is on the same page, no matter who gets this information. I would note, sometimes reporters go rogue and they break the embargo. It's a very rare situation because it completely destroys the trust between that reporter and yourself, and they don't want to do that. You don't want that to happen, but it can happen. So the only thing you can do there is make sure that you have a sort of paper trail that shows that this reporter agreed to the embargo. And, you know, you might have to talk to their editor, straighten things out. But if that's the case, there's sadly not a lot of options for you when that happens. Most journalists respect embargoes, but it can happen. And sometimes the comms person is the one that breaks the embargo. So once you have given a reporter something with a specific time for the embargo, do not send it to anyone else with a different time, especially if it's earlier. Once you have set that time, that is what you give everyone, regardless, even if they beg. Like, you can't mess with that. The last thing you want to do is have, you know, one story come out earlier, have the other reporter realize what just happened and give you a hard time. They'll probably publish it, but that's the end of that relationship with that reporter until you repair it somehow. So just, you know, be careful. It's pitching under embargo is super helpful because, you know, like I said, you get all this coverage ahead of, like, not ahead of time, but, you know, you've already done the work to get all this coverage, and then you can send out that release as regularly scheduled and know that you're going to have coverage for it. And that will help you. You know, we talked about ICYMIs in the Media 101. That's when you can whip up a real quick ICYMI and put that stuff out and try to get more coverage to piggyback off of that initial first wave. So it is a lot of work, but it is super helpful. And then we have an exclusive, which is just like a super newsworthy piece of information that you pitch to just one person, and that source will get the exclusive rights to your news, and they will be the first to break it. Exclusive pitches will save you some serious time in the front end, and it brings like a higher chance of coverage. Because, you know, a reporter getting exclusive to your story is just as important to them as it is to you. So this is really meant for like really big stories. Campaigns will usually use them when they're announcing like a launch, when they've decided to drop out, they will give it to one person to kind of avoid that frenzy. But say you have like a really important or like a really scathing report coming out, and you know it's going to be big news, and you know you want to be able to pay really close attention to just one and just work with one reporter so that they get everything right, and you can kind of walk them through it all, set up interviews for them, and just know that it's going to be like a really strong story. That's when you want to go with an exclusive. Usually, I would say you want to make sure that the outlet that you give this to or the reporter that you give this to is influential and will want to make other outlets kind of follow their lead. So that can mean that you give it to a wire service, like that would be like, think AP or Reuters. It's literally just any service that, you know, has stories and puts them out over the wire for other people that subscribe to them to use. So for example, like, say you give your story to your local AP reporter because you know that the other smaller papers in the area are subscribed to AP, and they'll pull it for their own coverage. And TV stations usually pull it. They'll use it to fill in their newscasts. They'll use it for their digital stories. So in a way, when you give it to a wire as an exclusive, you're working on one story, but you're going to get a ton of reposts from it, which is just as helpful. I would recommend establishing with the reporter when you send your initial email, very similar to what we just talked about, that you talk to them off the record about this. When you're pitching an exclusive, there's a chance that the first person you give it to, like your very top target, declines, and they hear you out and they decide it's just not something they can take on. They're already working on something else. Whatever the case may be, you always want to make sure that you have backups when you're pitching an exclusive story. So that means the last thing you want to do is give them everything on the record. And for whatever reason, later, like 2 days later, they decide that was a terrible mistake, I want to write this story, and you've already gone to your second top target and they've already accepted the exclusive. So you know, just make sure that when you talk to reporters, when you're pitching exclusives, you're off the record. And that way you can speak more openly and tell them about, you know, what you're thinking for the story and everything that you have to offer them. Negotiating an exclusive, I will say, might take a little bit of time, and that's totally fine. Sometimes talking about it over the phone is better than just emailing back and forth. So I would really recommend after that initial pitch email that you offer to hop on the phone with them and talk through it. And then that way, that also gives you a bit of a head start on things, because you want to make sure that you and the reporter are on the same page about where the story needs to go. You're shaping it, you're giving them all this time and effort, and you want to make sure that what you get out of it is exactly what you need out of it. So if the reporter is kind of pushing back on stuff, if they are not really in agreement with you about this story, likely they will pass on it, but also it's giving you like a lot of important information when you're on the phone with them about why you need to move on to the next person, or why this reporter is the right person and you are correct to go to them first. And just like the last one, once your story comes out, drop it into an ICYMI and blast it out and try to get more coverage from that one story. And the thing I recommend here is if you have like, if it's a study of sorts, if it's something that has a ton of different angles that are kind of nuanced, like, and you have the time to do this, I would recommend kind of finding what those angles are, have like picking them out for yourself and finding specific beat reporters that kind of like can zone in on that and write stories about the different parts of what your like what the larger story is. This kind of like, I think sometimes what you'll find is that you'll get the same story from every outlet. They might take your release and they'll write the same thing. They'll copy paste parts of it. And sometimes you want it to get into some of that nuance. So I highly recommend trying to get like a little bit more creative with your pitches, going to reporters that you might not usually go to. One example I can give is when I worked for the Congresswoman, we put forward a bill to help local artists get jobs after COVID. And the way we were wanting to do that was like through the infrastructure package. We wanted to make sure that part of that money went to artists so that when they were building a new bridge or something, that a local artist was like part of that money so that they could make it beautiful and, you know, make it part of the community. So what we did was, you know, we pitched that to all of obviously the political reporters, because this was something that the Congresswoman was doing. But we also went to a bunch of national outlets who covered the arts and started pitching them to see if they would be interested. And we got a ton of really good feedback and a ton of really good stories. We were able to offer up artists to talk to them. And it just became like this much bigger thing because we tried to get a little bit more creative about it. So when you're doing an exclusive, you know, be in the moment and like work with that reporter, but also start thinking about some of the other stories that could come out of it too. So once you have kind of, you know, identified, you know, how much on the record, off the record you want to be, what kind of pitch you want to do for this, then you can start the process of actually getting that pitch out the door. And usually step one for me is always identifying your hook. You know, what about this story is the most newsworthy, and that can prepare you for step two, which is drafting your press release and any additional materials, right? Like sometimes you'll have one pagers, you'll have bios and photos, and you want to make sure that all those things are being worked on simultaneously. Because you want to make sure that all of that stuff is in a good place to be sent to a reporter once you've actually sent that pitch out. And I would say operate under the assumption that like the best thing in the world's going to happen, you're going to send that pitch and the reporter is going to say yes immediately, and you're going to need everything ready to go so that they can start working on it. But then step three, decide what kind of pitch is most appropriate for you, type it out, draft a personalized one if you have the time to do it, but send it with enough lead time, especially if it's under embargo, especially if it's an exclusive. make sure that you're giving that reporter the time that they need, and that you're giving yourself the time that you need to have everything set up for the most successful pitch that you can have. So a couple of best practices here, like we already talked about, make it an email and keep it short. Like I think 2 to 3 paragraphs is pretty standard, but again, you're not giving them everything all at once. So make sure that there's something in there that catches their attention, that's personalized, and make sure the subject line is enough that they're going to open your email. Reporters are getting a ton of pitches at once. They're getting a bunch of other emails, and your email can get buried. So in the subject line, if it's an exclusive, write that in there. Whatever you have to do to get their attention, try to put that in the subject line. Number two is just having your materials and your spokespeople ready. If you're offering up people for interviews, or if you have one pagers on the issue or whatever it may be, make sure that those are ready to go by the time you hit send on that email. Spokespeople should be lined up. They should know that they're being offered for press. They do not need to be prepped just yet, but you should be ready to prep them at the drop of the hat if the reporter's like ready to get started. So there's like a little bit of prepping other people, but also yourself. And then I would say when you've identified your top targets, hopefully you're already following them on Twitter, but if you're not, you should make sure that you are. Most of the time, reporters might post about being on vacation or taking time off, or maybe they're working on a story and they're like updating their followers through their social. It'll kind of give you an insight into what they're working on or where they're at. Plus, sometimes they'll post about personal stuff, like things they think are funny, like shows they're watching. And if you can't find a way to make their pitch personalized because they just haven't written about what you're pitching, but you know that they're the right person for this, sometimes that's a way in, right? Like you can make it part of your email. Like if you're introducing yourself, you want to make it like a little bit more human. You know, mention that you saw their Twitter, that they were watching this, you were watching it too. You know, whatever you need to do to kind of set yourself apart and start building that relationship. And number four is just don't make promises you can't keep. The last thing you want to do is embellish your pitch and, you know, offer something that you hope you might be able to get for them, but you're not sure about. If that's the case, like be as transparent with them as you can when you're pitching. Like don't overpromise, don't lie to them about what you can, how you can hook it up for them. Just, you know, keep it very real with them and they'll appreciate it. And if by chance, you know, something changes on the line and you can offer something more up, that can come down the line, but you don't have to give them everything from the get-go and kind of end up looking bad in front of them. And when you follow up, I didn't include this in here, but when you follow up, after you sent that first email, follow up within the first week. I would try them 1 or 2 times before you move on from them. But especially if you're pitching an exclusive, follow up like as much as you can, try to get them on the phone if possible. But if you haven't heard back from them in that 1 to 2 follow-up period, it might be time for you to move on to the next target. So then we come to identifying spokespeople. There are going to be times where you'll want to have people lined up to talk to press on your behalf. But before you start to identify who those people are, it's kind of important to know when you actually might need it, because it's not always super necessary. So when do you need to offer up a spokesperson? I would say, you know, sometimes you have a subject that you know might interest reporters more if they're able to talk about it with someone who has lived through it or who is an expert at it. That's when you want to put in the work to find someone that will do just that and kind of validate that pitch. So for example, like I worked with the American Lung Association for a while. We pitched a lot of studies about air pollution. So you can imagine, like, unless you were a very experienced environmental reporter and that it like was an expert in like air particles, some of these studies were just really hard to read. They were hard to digest. And the only way that we could get reporters to really bite and report on what was going on in certain communities was to connect them with people in that community that could properly communicate how air pollution had impacted their lives, how it had impacted their children, and just put it in layman's terms for people to understand and for people to care, quite frankly. So when you need to humanize an issue, this is when you want a spokesperson to. And finally, like, and this is kind of beyond pitching and beyond the proactive aspect of this work, but if you ever find yourself in a situation where you have to be reactive to the news, you need to respond, a spokesperson is usually helpful here, but we won't go into crisis communications for the sake of this training. So if you do need a spokesperson for your particular situation, how to best identify a spokesperson, it really has to be someone that people can trust and believe. And this means a little work on your end of making sure that you research this person, make sure there are no issues, having this person's name attached to your organization. Sometimes that's not as important, but you do want to make sure that you're fully covered, especially on campaigns we had to do this, just like research people that we put up to talk on behalf of the campaign. But this just kind of covers your back a little bit. This should be someone that people can relate to, or if they can't relate to the issue that they're talking about, someone that just has a really strong story that people can connect with. The last thing you want is to have someone who speaks with no passion, who can't break through the jargon, like say they're experts at something. If they can't talk to you and have you understand it, like as a regular person who is not entrenched in these issues, that's probably not the right person for you to put in front of a reporter. This is also someone that is open to making sure that at the end of the day, your goals are met through their interview. So, you know, if it's someone within your organization, that's pretty cut and dry, like they're going to be on board with this. But if it's someone from the outside, you know, you want to make sure that you're filling them in on why you're pitching this, what you're trying to get out of it, and they should be aligned with that mission. And also it should, frankly, be someone that takes feedback well and that can be directed, because you're going to need to coach them through some of this. And this one feels very obvious, but you could find the perfect validator, perfect spokesperson, and they are not available in the timeline that you need them. Like, say you found the most perfect person to talk about your topic, but you want to launch your study on this week and they are on vacation and they think they might be available, but maybe not. That just means they're not the right spokesperson. It means more work on your end to find someone else, but you just want to make sure that their availability is there for you. One of the biggest insecurities or points of pushback people have when you approach them about talking with press is that they're not going to be able to answer the reporter's questions and they don't want to be faced with tough questions. And a good thing to remind them is that they absolutely do not need to worry about that, because the question that they should be asking themselves is in the next slide, and that is, do you have questions for my answers? The biggest point of prepping your spokesperson is getting them to a comfortable place with the points that you need them to hit and in a headspace where they're able to work those points in no matter how a question is posed to them. The best example I can give here is when we're getting ready for candidates to launch a campaign. We're prepping them for their very first interviews and they are so nervous about how are they going to answer questions about the economy if that's not like a thing that they're super comfortable talking about? How are they going to answer questions about the environment if that's something that they've studied? And the simple answer here is that you just need to go to the stuff that you do know and find a way to talk about those no matter how the question is asked. So, you know, we'll talk through some tough questions, say we ask about the economy while we're prepping them. And we always have to remind them to start with their personal story, right? So like you have your spokesperson that has lived through something, you don't want them to answer the way that a scientist would, the way that a politician would, you want them to answer the way a regular person would. So always remind them if that's a pushback you're getting when you're asking people to be spokespeople for you. If the pushback you're getting is, I don't think I can answer a reporter's question. Yes, I am. You're right, Melissa. That is the question. That is the reason why candidates never answer a question straight up. It's because people like me telling them that they don't have to. But it will make finding spokespeople easier for you when you kind of give them that ease, like put them at ease that, you know, they don't have to repeat the question back to a reporter. They can just answer it the way that they feel most comfortable doing it. So when you're prepping them, I would say if this is someone who is not used to working with press, who maybe is a little hesitant and can't seem to remember some of their points because they're so in their head, give them the easy way out and like identify those 3 to 4 points that you really need them to hit, and put it in an email, put it in a Word doc for them and send it to them. If facts and figures are appropriate, that's fine to have, but I would say the most important parts to remind them what part about their story they should be talking about. And sometimes we call these green zones. You can call them whatever comes most natural to you. But it's helpful when they have that to think about, like, I don't have to worry about knowing everything about the subject. I just have to worry about remembering to work in these 3 to 4 points into my interview. Sometimes you want to do a prep doc for them. It usually takes some time. So I would only recommend doing that when you have like a longer form interview, any 10 to 30 minute interview. That's usually when I do a prep doc. And we're talking about doing like a really quick 2 minute hit with a reporter that's at an event. I wouldn't do it then. I would keep it to just identifying those 3 to 4 points and making sure that they feel really comfortable about that. And then finally, if you have time, you might not, and that's totally fine. But if you have time to schedule some prep sessions with your spokespeople, that is usually super helpful. And you can usually work out a lot of the kinks in, you know, 30 minutes to an hour with them. Essentially you just get on the phone, you hop on Zoom, or if you're in person, you do it in person. But you just talk about, you know, kind of work them into it, like slightly tell them how long they'll have with them, who the reporter is, and then practice some questions with them. Come prepared with some of the questions that you know they'll get asked, or some of the questions that you think they might be nervous to get asked, and work through it with them. Sometimes when I do these with people, I like to take notes during it and then send it to them afterwards, which I'll show you guys an example of. But that can be really helpful for you also, because it just reminds you, like right before the interview, these are the things I need to remind them of. These are the things that we talked about. And, you know, they'll appreciate that. It'll make you feel better. It's a really good use of time if you have it. And the next slide is an example of what that memo could look like for you. We would do these for the Congresswoman all the time, but essentially you have a description of what it is and how long it is. Any notes, like logistical notes that you need them to be aware of. Do's and don'ts, like, you know, whatever, you know your spokespeople better than anyone else. So whatever you think they need to feel more at ease and feel more comfortable in that setting, include that in there for them. But at the bottom, I always like to have like a things to highlight section, and add some of those talking points in there. And then in the next slide, this is more of a example of what it looks like when we type up prep notes. We always like to have like what question was asked and kind of break out the answer that they gave and give them that feedback again. Some people, I have done this before where some people prefer to hear themselves back. And then there are people that absolutely hate hearing their own voice. So whatever works best for them. I usually like to give it to them written out because it's easier for them to read through and really understand what made that answer good and how that feedback makes it better. But it's really helpful. It's helpful for you and it's helpful for them. So it's usually a good use of your time. And then some reminders, just gentle reminders for them. Make sure that they understand the question that they're being asked. I don't know how many people have seen that really funny clip of Demi Lovato being asked what her favorite dish is, and she answered with a bowl. Just make sure that they know what they're being asked, and to not be afraid to ask for clarifications if it's necessary. The last thing you want is to have like an obnoxious answer and, you know, carry that with you through the rest of the interview. So better to ask questions than to not. The other thing is, be clear. Sometimes people tend to ramble on for a really long time when they could have just had 2 to 3 really solid sentences that drove the point across. It's another reason why you might want to do prep sessions. It just lets them get all of that ranting out of the way before they can really narrow in on those points. But another thing is to keep it simple. You're essentially, you know, whenever you're pitching, it's because you want regular people to kind of see the story. So you want to make sure that they understand what you're saying. So if you're, say, you're like an expert in this field, and you know, you want to make sure you get your point across. Don't use too much jargon. Just keep it really simple. Be yourself. Like, don't try to be anyone else. Use your own stories. Use your own life experience where possible. And really just let your personality come across. And this one is the hardest because it's hard to be relaxed around reporters sometimes. But try to relax. Try to keep it conversational and speak with confidence, and just like remind them that mistakes can happen. And if they misspeak, you know, simply say so. And if they feel comfortable clearing it up with them right then and there, that's okay to do. You can't really control whether they end up printing it, but say you have an outside spokesperson doing this in your staffing, you catch that back and forth where they have to clear it up. Then it's really your job to kind of come in at the end and be like, you know, oh, I'm glad they cleared it up. Like, just let me know if you have any questions or if any of that didn't make sense. You know, that way they, you know, that you did your job and they understand that it's nothing malicious. It's nothing that they should really pay that close attention to and cover. But if they're flying solo and you're not there to step in and help out, just remind any spokesperson to let you know ASAP if they realize after the fact that they messed up and they gave wrong information, so that you can go in and correct it. But these are just some gentle reminders for any spokesperson that you ever have. And these next ones are reminders if you ever put them on TV. You can screenshot it, but I or read it through, but you know, never look directly at the camera, wear solid colors, don't wear white, nothing too flashy that will distract the camera or viewers from what you're saying. Loud jewelry can really get in the way when you're mic'd up. But the one that I really do want to emphasize is that sometimes you take all the time in the world to make sure that what's coming out of their mouth is perfect, and you forget that you're putting them on TV, and that they tend to, when they're nervous, they bounce their leg, or they, you know, mess around with their hands a lot. So you want to remind them, you know, you're about to like walk them into the studio. They're about to set up for a TV interview. Remind them to sit at the edge of the chair so that they're not like super leaning back, to lean forward and, you know, be interactive with whoever is being, they're being interviewed by. And if they have a thing with their hands, they just don't know what to do. My go-to usually is to tell them to pretend like they're holding a ball, and the ball can grow, right? But always come back to your little ball and make sure that it kind of stays pretty centered to you. Don't get crazy with it. If they have to move their hands, just try to keep them here. And avoid shifting too much, like bouncing your legs. The congresswoman, whenever she would do TV hits, she'd be standing. You would kind of see her do this, and it would drive me insane. No matter how many times I told her, I was like, please, for the love of God, like don't do this. It's super distracting. But these are just things to remind them as they're walking on. And then staffing interviews. This is probably my favorite thing to do. Don't be afraid to staff interviews. It means you get to see your hard work in action, and it gives you some insight, and you learn about the best ways to prep different types of people. So some best practices, for phone interviews, always try to be the one that dials it in. So call your spokesperson first, make sure you remind them of the reporter's name, remind them that you'll be on the phone with them. If it's going over, you can, you know, let them know that you'll step in, just like gentle reminders to put them in a good headspace, and then dial in the reporter, remind them how much time they have, thank them again for taking the time, merge them, sit back, take some notes, put yourself on mute, and you're pretty much done. For any virtual or Zoom interviews, try to get on it, just mute yourself, turn your camera off, and watch it happen. And take notes. Like, I like to write down the questions that were asked and like quick hand, whether I'm typing or writing it out, some of like parts of the answer that caught my attention, whether because they were really good answers or because there's stuff that you can tweak for the next one to make it even better. So try to take down notes. If you are in a situation where you're in person, like you're with them physically, and you don't want to be writing like in the air, take out your phone and type some notes into your notes app. But this is specifically helpful because sometimes like the spokesperson will come to you at the end and say like, okay, what do you have for me? What feedback do you have? The first time that I was asked that, I had absolutely no feedback because my brain just was not working fast enough and I was just so overwhelmed. So it's a muscle that you have to work on, and taking notes is super helpful. It reminds you of some of the earlier questions. I tend to forget the first question when I get to the end of the interview, and it's just helpful to go back and remember what I noticed throughout. So that'll help you really kind of exercise that muscle. Time the interview. You know, if you know you gave them 10 minutes, when you get on, just keep an eye on the clock. And if you need to step in and let them know like, hey, we have 2 minutes left. If you notice a reporter is not anywhere close to being done, find a time that makes sense in their conversation and unmute and step in and pull your person out or allow them to have more time, whatever you think is best in that moment. But make sure you're keeping an eye on the clock and don't let it go over too much. But it's a really fun experience if you do it. And it only gets better the more you do it. So I know we just went through a good chunk of stuff. If anyone has any questions, I know I saw a non-urgent question from Morgan. Do you send your ICYMIs to the same press list you sent releases to initially? Yes, always. Make sure that the people that got your invitation to something, that got your information about something, are also seeing the work that you put into it after. In a way, it's a good follow-up. Sometimes, like we talked about in the 101 training, sometimes you can get additional coverage out of an ICYMI, but sometimes it just means that the reporter kind of sees the work that you put into it and will want to go to the next one. So yes, same press list. If anyone else has any questions, or if you think of any questions later on, please feel free to contact me at your disposal if you need anything, if you want any clarifications or whatever the case may be, just let me know.
Hey, Maria, this is Daisy. I hope that you don't mind sharing a little bit more on your background and how you got to the position that you are now. And now I am currently a communications assistant, and I feel like the biggest hurdle for my growth to move to like a deputy, et cetera, would be like on the record experience. And I'm currently getting mentorship at my job, but I guess if you don't mind sharing how you jumped from like assistant to like on the record, et cetera. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for asking that. I had a very similar experience where, you know, sometimes you start as an assistant, you're not given the opportunity to do the next thing, and it's hard to apply for those jobs having not done the work that is required of you. But I had a really good experience in that I had people above me that kind of allowed me to, but it really just required a lot of me nagging them to like, please put me on the record. I asked them to start off with written responses. So if you ever get an inquiry from a reporter, that does not require a phone call, and it can be a written response, I asked for my name to put on those. Like, I offered to draft it, to work it through approvals, and for it at the end to have my name in it so that I could say that I was on the record. And then once I was a little bit more comfortable with that, I started nagging everyone to let me talk to reporters. The way I did that mostly is that no one wanted to staff events. So I offered to do that. It breaks my heart because it's so annoying that you have to put in all this extra work that no one particularly wants to do, just so that you can be taken seriously enough to move up. But that was my experience. I kind of just had to do this like grunt work that put me sometimes in kind of uncomfortable positions, not out of like safety reasons or anything, just because I just like hadn't done that work and there was no one there to kind of guide me through it. But I think just, you know, try to talk to reporters as much as you can. And quite frankly, even if you don't know how to do some of the stuff that is required of you to move up, like still apply to them, still do it, because honestly, I know that you would be able to do it if you got the job. So, but if you really want to do it in your current position, try to find creative ways to have your name, put your name to statements, put your name on the top of a release, and really just try to be that like that point of contact, even if it's just as small as like being the one that takes in the RSVPs for an event for reporters. That that means that you get to talk to them. That means that you might get to do the follow-ups and make sure that they're there. And then when you get to the event, that you're the point of contact. Like stuff like that goes, I think, a really long way. And it makes you also more comfortable in your own abilities to get it done. So hopefully that helped.
It did. Thanks so much for your response.
Of course. Melissa, I see a question. Any tips on preparing spokespeople that are directly impacted by tough issues? Their info might be sensitive. Yeah, I think in those situations, it's important for you to have a one-on-one conversation with them first. Engage what they're comfortable saying. The last thing you want to do in that situation is approach them with those like 3 to 4 points and say, this is what we want you to hit. In those situations, it's best when you can build trust with them and you show them that you have respect for their story. So in those situations, I usually pull prep up and I start with that. It's just a conversation between two people. You know, ask them to tell you about their experience, kind of dig in and ask them questions and see what they're comfortable sharing. And if there's parts of their story that they are not comfortable sharing that you think actually might be really impactful and really important for people to understand and hear, that's something you can tell them, right? Like, and you can figure out ways with reporters to, maybe you want to put them on background, and you can work on them with that. So the best thing to do there is explain to them why you would like for them to be straight up about their story and like not try to edit it down for whatever reason. If it's really sensitive and they really don't want their name on it, you know, maybe they can go off the record, and it at least gives the reporter some of the heart and soul of the story. If they don't have time to talk to off the record spokespeople, just because they're on like a really tight timeline and they just need to talk to people who are gonna be able to be named as a source in their story, offer it, like write it down for, like write it out for them. Be like, hey, I have the story that has to be off the record, but I want you to hear it. And they usually will work with you there too. Nate, I see your hand up.
Hi, yes, Maria, thank you so much. This has been so helpful. My question is kind of tailing off of Melissa around folks with sensitive information. I found it to be difficult to really pitch or to get reporters interested when there's a level of anonymity where they are not really, but they're not really able to name or obtain the full name of their source and like where folks are being detained, like what country they're from, and certain things that for you know, cases or just levels of safety, you can't really share with reporters. So what are some ways to kind of pitch successfully around that, or like get, you know, kind of get them excited and show up and cover things with that, those information?
Yeah, I've had that happen to me so many times. And you're gonna have reporters who just are really stubborn and won't go and won't work with you on it. And sometimes I try to think about it. I'm like, okay, I can't get mad because I have to work with them on other stuff. And I can't blame them sometimes because, you know, newsrooms are shrinking and they're under a lot of pressure. If you're really stuck in this place where you just can't find anyone who might be able to be on the record, who might be willing to even talk to a reporter, it just gets really tough, and it might be that you just have to look to other places. Like maybe they have, maybe it's not related to them, but you have other people who are close to people who have similar stories who might be willing to go on the record and talk to reporters and kind of give their story about, maybe they work with them, like at a different organization or whatever it might be. You just kind of want to look, I mean, sometimes you get to like, you zoom out a little bit too much and then that story just gets so muddled and it becomes this like, he said, she said type of thing, and you lose that human aspect to the story that you're pitching. I hate to say that, like when that's happened to me, it's really just been a grind of keeping on trying to find the right person that will be able to tell that story. And sometimes it is worth holding on pitching that story or getting that story written to find the right person that will do it, that won't put them in any sort of danger, that won't compromise anything that they have going on. I mean, I think the last thing you want to do, and I'm sure you've no one in this training has ever done this, but like, you know, pressuring someone to go forward with their story is, I've only ever seen it backfire on people. You don't want someone to kind of get through the middle and decide, this is not it, I don't want to do this, and back out, and you lose your story and you lose all this work that you've done. So if there's no way to get creative about it, it really just is a matter of holding on to your pitch until you have the right circumstance and the right hook. And it's a shitty answer, I'm so sorry, but whenever it's like really sensitive subjects that you're working with, it just makes it that much harder, but also that much more worth it when you do get it published in a way that makes sense to everyone involved. Great. Well, thank you guys. I'd love doing these with you. And thank you for all your questions.
Yes, thank you, everyone. Before you jump off, I have one more thing for everybody. We really, really take the feedback we get seriously. We look at it, we look at what people took away from trainings, what, you know, they could do less of, what other trainings they might be interested in. So please, if you can take a moment, it's a really quick survey. It'd be really helpful for our team, and I will drop this in the chat as well. The screen share is gone. All right. One second. Let me pull that back up. There we go. That should be back up. And the link is also shared in the chat. Again, we really, really value the feedback. Thank you to Maria so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it. And I will just play music and let you all leave when you're ready.
Thanks, y'all.